Previously, we talked in depth about the floating point format, specifically the IEEE floating point format specification for 32-bit numbers and the bitwise representation of them. And that's a mouthful. So we have the sign, the mantissa, and the exponent. And the mantissa is always represented as 1 point, the actual value that's stored in the mantissa field. The one before the binary point is implied, and we never store that, so that the number is always normalized. But this gives rise to a tricky situation. If the value of the mantissa is always 1 point something, then how do we represent zero? That's where the special conditions come in. I'd mentioned in the previous video that two states of the exponents were reserved for these special conditions. All zeros and all ones. If all of the bits of the exponent are zero, and if all of the bits of the mantissa are zero as well, then this combination is represented as the number zero. It doesn't matter what the sign bit is, it can be negative or positive, but the floating point processor disregards this and considers the number as zero. Let's look at a couple of scenarios where we need to express a certain concept in mathematics, but it cannot be expressed as a definitive number. What happens when you divide something by zero? If you were to perform integer division by zero, programming languages tend to throw exceptions, stating that division by zero is illegal. But you can also argue that the result of division by zero tends towards infinity. So, infinity is a concept in mathematics that can't be defined as a precise number, but rather as a concept. And in floating point numbers, you can express this. If all of the bits of the exponent are set to 1, and if all of the bits of the mantissa are set to 0, then this results in the floating point number being interpreted as infinity. Another possible category of results that can be formed are invalid numbers. Calculations that are illegal for floating point numbers, and results in numbers which are either undefined or aren't real numbers. These are results from operations like 0 divided by 0, which is truly undefined, or operations like the square root of a negative number, which you could argue that it results in an imaginary number, but this isn't in the set of real numbers, so it's an illegal value and cannot be represented in the floating point format. The way you represent the concept of an illegal value is by setting all of the exponent bits to 1 and having any combination of the mantissa, other than it all being zeros, because when the mantissa is all zero, the number is infinity. So this representation is called NaN, or not a number. Let's check some of these conditions out with a little bit of C++. Again, the language doesn't really matter here. The behavior of these operations will be the exact same across all languages which adopt the IEEE floating point standard, which pretty much all popular languages do. And the behavior is the same across all underlying hardware as well. The IEEE floating point format is the de facto standard. So I've got variables 1 and 0 here, set to the floating point 1 and 0. Let's look at a non-zero number divided by 0 and a 0 divided by 0. The result of 1 divided by 0 is infinity, like we discussed, and the result of 0 divided by 0 is this weird representation, negative NaN and IND in brackets. IND stands for indeterminate number, and NaN is not a number. There are certain computations whose results cannot be determined by the floating point unit, and they are marked as IND, but for all practical purposes, it's not a number. The result of the square root of negative 1, again, is not a number. You can build NaNs and infinities using these sort of expressions, or you can manually bit set them to what the compiler expects a floating point number to be, but there are utility methods to give you these values, and they're in the limits header. And they're all static functions under the numeric limits class. I can initialize INF and NaN using these functions. Now there are certain properties in infinities and NaNs that are probably worth knowing. Check out these statements here. They're all involving infinities. You can add infinity to an arbitrary number, infinity plus infinity, infinity minus infinity, infinity times infinity, infinity divided by infinity, infinity times zero, infinity divided by zero. And then are two infinities equal? This last statement is a comparison between two infinities, and we'll see what the result is. But before that, just try to put some values into what you think the results would be. Infinity plus any number is infinity. Infinity minus infinity is not a number. Infinity times infinity is infinity. Infinity divided by infinity is not a number. Infinity times zero is not a number. Infinity divided by zero is infinity for some reason. Comparison of infinity equal to infinity is true. Surprising again. So yeah, operations on infinities either results in infinity or not a number. And no, you don't need to remember any of these. No self-respecting developer would intentionally write any of these statements. Your intermediate calculations could possibly end up with one of these operations, but the output of such calculations would probably not be very useful either. So let's quickly look at some operations on NaNs. The same drill as before. I'll just print these out. So you can see operations on NaNs always results in NaNs, and the equality comparison between two NaNs would always result in false. So let's finally go back to the list of special conditions we've seen in this video. You can see that there's one condition that's possibly missing. What happens when the exponent is all zeros and the mantissa isn't? I've deliberately excluded this till the end because this is not a very easy topic to talk about and probably something that you wouldn't encounter very often. But it is something that you need to know, and when you do encounter it and all the weird behavior that follows it, you'll be equipped to diagnose and handle those cases. Welcome to the world of subnormal numbers.